Hi everyone, I'm Chris Saldaña, and this is the National Education Policy Center's Education Interview of the Month. This month, we're speaking with Dr. Lorrie Shepard. Dr. Shepard is the University Distinguished Professor in the School of Education at the University of Colorado Boulder. She's a past president of both the American Educational Research Association and the National Council on Measurement in Education, and her research focuses on psychometrics and the use and misuse of tests in educational settings. Dr. Shepard, thank you for being on the podcast.
I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
So there has been a significant amount of attention paid to the Biden administration's decision to require states to administer standardized tests this year, but there was a period in our country's history when standardized tests were not as ubiquitous as they are today. So what would you say was the original intent for using standardized tests in schools, and why and when did that begin to change?
Well, the accountability emphasis that we experience today actually is about 40 years old. So the answer to your question goes back longer ago than that. Before accountability became the focus of standardized testing, interestingly, standardized tests were administered to inform parents a little, and also were used to evaluate school programs, but not the way accountability works today. That has grown decade by decade. What people experience today is 20 years old, but there was accountability testing before that. But then the federal law referred to as No Child Left Behind passed 20 years ago, and basically it added to consequences. It made it worse if you didn't do well, and it also added to the amount of testing. So the weight of testing has steadily increased decade by decade.
What was the logic behind accountability? And would you say that that logic was rational given disparities in school quality and school resources?
The people who have strong opinions in favor of accountability testing say that they're going to remedy inequality in schools by using incentives. And if you look back at who was writing articles 20 years ago, there were a number of important reports, including a compendium from the National Academy of Sciences, where people came together and said, we have to use the rewards and punishments that economists have found to work in other contexts. Let's use that in education. I would say that was the gist of the argument, and still is, for strong advocates of accountability testing.
So how have the pressures played out in wealthier schools, for example, versus schools who may not have the resources to improve their academic outcomes that easily?
Well, that's an interesting question. What has happened is that the schools that do well, and largely because they serve advantaged populations of students, are a little freer. They can invest in project-based learning or take field trips or do provide richer learning experiences than the poorer schools and districts that are under scrutiny. They are under such pressure to raise test scores that we find this phenomenon that's been documented by countless research studies over the last couple of decades. They focus on test preparation. Teaching the test is the phrase that's used the most. And it's a very repetitive, drill-focused instructional format, very different from the schools that do well.
You've also written a lot about the way that standardized tests can change the way that teachers teach. So what are some examples of how standardized tests change how teachers approach supporting their students or teaching curricula?
Well, there are several different levels. One of the things that's been well documented is, again, disproportionately in the lowest performing schools, focus on reading and math tests, which is what the federal law requires predominantly, has caused social studies and science, art and music virtually to disappear from the curriculum, so that the focus on the tests narrows the curriculum is the phrase that's used, but it happens in multiple ways. So I've just mentioned the other important and sometimes more interesting and meaningful content areas are neglected. But in addition, the way that reading and math are taught is more procedural, more drill and memorization, more rote learning, less conceptual, less applied, less here's why you would want to learn this in the first place. So people use phrases like decontextualization and commodification. So you take the skill that has to be memorized out of context and you make it harder to learn. You make it less worthwhile to learn because you take away the context of how you would use it. And then you also teach the kids who are subjected to this kind of instruction that the reason for learning is to score well on tests, as opposed to learning because it's exciting, because it's useful, because it's like something that your friends and neighbors use in contexts that are purposeful. So you really are taking meaning away from learning.
So you've listed various reasons to be concerned about the what standardized tests can, and specifically applying consequences to standardized test outcomes can have on teachers and students. But and you also mentioned that now the current regime of standardized testing and accountability has been around for about 40 years. So I guess the million-dollar question is, has it worked?
No. And I think actually the people, I think that there is increasing recognition that it hasn't worked. So I served on a consensus report panel for the National Academy of Sciences a decade ago. And at that time, we pulled together all of the comparative studies that showed the effects on outcomes. And the conclusion at that time was that the effect of accountability testing over the previous two decades had raised the average achievement in this country or in the states where the studies were located on average about a tenth of a standard deviation. So that is, in quotes, statistically significant, but not necessarily practically significant. It's a small effect compared to many other educational interventions that matter. And it's not nearly on the scale of the change that people say needs to happen. Alongside that so-called positive effect, which is it's there, statistically documented, we have all the negative effects. We have all the things kids aren't learning. We have stress in schools. We have, I've mentioned already, the commodification, the orientation toward why you would do schoolwork in the first place, being distorted, and especially being distorted for the kids in lower scoring schools in poor neighborhoods that the advocates say they're trying to help, and yet they're condemning them to a really, really unfortunate and in some ways debilitating set of opportunities, taking away opportunity instead of providing opportunity.
These conversations have been going on for a very long time, obviously, but now we're almost a year and some weeks into a global pandemic, which changes everything about how schools operate and how students might take standardized tests. So there was a question about whether the Biden administration would continue the Trump administration's policy of canceling standardized tests this year. Obviously, now we know that they didn't and that they're requiring states to administer tests to all students. What do you think motivated the administration's decision? And do you agree with it? And if not, what concerns do you have?
Well, I'll say first that I disagree with it strongly, and I'll try to provide some explanation. Why did they do it? I think they were under a lot of pressure. A lot of Beltway groups were arguing that they had to give the test this year since DeVos had exempted people at the start of the pandemic last year, that we had to have the data because we can't respond to the equity needs if we don't have the data. And that drumbeat was pretty strong. A lot of pressure was put on the U.S. Department of Education not to suspend testing this year again. I have to acknowledge that some Washington seemingly national civil rights groups also signed a letter to the U.S. Department of Education saying they wanted the data. I point out that they're national and Beltway because I know of civil rights organizations in states and districts that are appalled at the insistence on testing. So it's hard to resolve. Why did people think we had to test to help the communities that have been most affected during the pandemic? And I think that the groups that are advocating for testing have, first of all, been persuaded that it's possible to do it and to collect good data. That's not actually true. In addition, I think that they've not been aware of the fact that you cannot pinpoint who has the greatest needs if you don't have 95% participation in the testing. What people seem to want to be able to do is to take 2019 scores, subtract 2021 scores, and call the difference in scores learning loss. But that only works if the students tested in 2021 are a full representation, 95% participation, which was required in 2019. That won't happen this year because people cannot all be in school to be tested. And the Department of Education has required testing, but exempted schools from the 95% requirement. So as soon as you have a big departure from 95%, you will not have accurate data. I've heard it said that bad data is better than no data. That's not true. So I think that people have misunderstood what can actually be done. The Department of Education, for example, said that, well, we'll allow remote administration. But what technical experts will tell you is that remote standardized tests are not comparable to the in-person standardized tests. So most states that I'm aware of are trying to do in-person testing because they know they can't combine the results from remote and in person. So that'd be an example of what I'm saying is just the basic information was not shared appropriately. So the department thinks, of course you can go ahead and test because you could use remote testing. Not true. And it would be highly inequitable, in fact, to use remote testing where some kids have a quiet space to do it, where some kids have parent help, and other kids do not. A whole other story about whether or not there could be secure proctoring, which would be an invasion of privacy. So once again, to my knowledge, states are not considering that kind of remote proctoring and remote testing.
You mentioned that one of the reasons that advocates want tests is to be able to pinpoint where the greatest need may be. Are there other ways to pinpoint what students are going to need the most help going forward?
Well, I think we have to make a distinction between which students and which school districts, because those are two different testing issues. If you want to make aggregate decisions to allocate federal dollars, for example, that's a district level or in turn, a state then might need to decide how districts are going to allocate money to schools. Better ways to do that would be to use the 2019 data that's complete, to use the kind of data that's used for Title I resource allocations already, plus information about the kinds of things we know affected schools and children disproportionately, such as lack of access to internet connectivity, lack of computers, etc. So there, we could take test score data that is complete, that shows us relative learning needs prior to the pandemic, and then add the information about whether some schools and districts were more affected by the pandemic than others. For children, that's a different matter. Some people think that the state test could be used to help teachers, but they fail to recognize that the state accountability tests were never designed to be instructionally targeted in the first place. And so most districts, the large majority of districts, already administer other kinds of so-called interim tests that tell them information about individual students.
So the administration has offered states some flexibility in how they choose to administer tests to students. For example, schools will be able to provide tests remotely. They will be able to give the tests in the summer or the fall or make tests shorter. The department also invited states to apply for waivers that would free them from some of the accountability provisions tied to testing, including the one that requires 95% participation. And administration officials have said that no student should be brought into school just to take a test if they're not able to do so safely. So do any of these options alleviate any of your concerns?
Well, the one, thank heavens, that students should not be forced to come into school to take a test is a good provision. It is the thing that opens the door to my expectation that there will be very uneven participation, which means that the reason people say they want the state summative tests is for comparability. They want a test that is uniform across each state so that districts can't be using different tests to compare their results. But in fact, you will not have comparability this year because you will have uneven participation. And 60% in one school compared to 80% participation in another school means that when those two schools have different scores, you won't know if it's because the kids know different amounts or if the missing kids are the reason for the test score difference. It's impossible to claim comparability when there are going to be gross differences in participation rates. So in addition to this worry about bringing kids in, a thing that the department did not consider is the fact that so many school districts have loaned out their computers to the kids who most needed them. This is, they've had them since last spring. This has been really important so that kids who didn't have computers at home would be have access to online learning during all this time in the pandemic. And now, because of the requirement to test, school districts are having to retrieve those computers, bring them into the school for weeks, minimum 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks, that the kids who most needed them are going to have to do without their computers because they have to come into the school, they have to wipe them clean to make sure there's no information that could be used during the testing period. They have to have them for socially distanced occasions to administer the test to all the students, and then they have to wipe them clean of the testing information before they finally give them back to the kids who most need them. And I can't believe that people who claim that they're doing this for equity are willing to take those computers away from kids to be able to administer the tests.
How can teachers best approach this situation?
Well, I think teachers should do less test preparation than has been typical in previous years. And we've known that that was disproportionate in districts with low scores where there was a lot of pressure on raising test scores. I think teachers should focus on learning and only prepare for the tests insofar as they need to help the kids soften the stress, as opposed to learn this and learn that and insistently trying to get kids ready to do their best on the tests. I think they should focus on learning and help the kids with integrity participate in the tests process, but not actually put too much weight on it. I think they need to help the kids have a healthy attitude toward taking the test.
Given that the test will be administered, how do you see, if at all, the data being useful?
Well, there are various statistical adjustments that can be made to compensate for the unevenness that I'm talking about. So various experts have already suggested analysis strategies where you would use the data only on the kids for whom you had prior scores, and compare prior scores from 2017 to 2019. That would give you a baseline rate of improvement. Then that in turn could be used to see whether the 2019-2021 gains were less than. That might be labeled as learning loss if we had a basis for comparison. So there are statistical adjustments, but that's not what's going to get reported in the newspaper. So I am in favor of, given the data, we can try to make sense out of subsets of the data. I'm the most concerned about the time and emotional costs of the testing itself, and that the raw data will actually cause some misinformation rather than being helpful.
So hopefully this pandemic will end soon. Hopefully this won't be around forever. And the issue of participation and where students will be taking the test will cease to be a problem. We can assume that tests will be a part of educational policy going forward. So what, if any, lessons from the pandemic do you hope that policymakers learn about how they design and implement accountability policies?
Earlier, we discussed the fact that people have come to understand that these accountability incentive-driven systems have not done what people hoped 20 years ago they were going to get out of No Child Left Behind has not come true. And I think that there's enough public dissatisfaction with the testing environment and the narrowing that has been documented that I do think when reauthorization is considered of the existing federal legislation, that people will think again. So specifically, I think that the state level tests should not be so burdensome. So there are procedures like matrix sampling where each student takes only a part of the larger test. It allows you to have a broad coverage then without any one person taking too much of a test. This is how the National Assessment of Educational Progress, for example, is run. It lets you know important things about schools, districts, and states without trying to evaluate every student. The decision that you had to have a valid test score for every student is what's driving the shape of the current program. And I think there's a lot of interest in rethinking that. And if we could have a state test with what I say is a lighter touch, just not be so burdensome, you could still gather some good data to use for state level and district level policies, but you wouldn't have it steal the springtime of so much schooling.
So much of the policy focus has been on state-standardized tests. But you've written a lot about formative assessments as well. So how do you see a place for formative assessments and standardized tests going forward, a better balance between a test that could provide some instructional benefits for teachers and a test that would provide the data that advocates and policymakers are asking for?
Well, there's certainly a need for better balance, which is why I'm advocating for less weight on the state test. But I don't want that to mean that then we need a test for formative purposes, because much of the really, really high quality formative assessment doesn't look like a quiz or a test. It's actually instructional tasks or questioning or observation of project work that allows teachers and students to self-evaluate, but it allows teachers and students to talk about the qualities of work and what needs to be revised to improve, what new learning is needed. Those formative purposes can be so embedded in instruction that you don't need a separate instrument. In fact, as soon as you bring in a separate instrument, you tend to do the same things we worry about at the state level, which is, you know, there are only certain ways, like with multiple choice formats, that people seem to be able to make these tests. And it invariably narrows the learning goals. It's not a full representation of what you really want the kids to be able to do. So it's better to stick with the instructional processes, stick with writing, stick with presenting a poster where I talk about my reasoning, all of these kinds of ways of interacting with kids where you're connecting better to their actual understandings and interacting with that. So when I say formative assessment, I'm talking about informal practices more than formal, though you still would do some formal instrumentation. Most of it should be within instruction in ways that doesn't look like a test at all.
Thank you, Dr. Shepard. Next month, we'll be speaking with Dr. Ann Ishimiru, an associate professor in the Educational Foundations Leadership and Policy Program in the College of Education at the University of Washington. Dr. Ishimiru's scholarship focuses on the intersection of leadership, school-community relationships, and educational equity in P-12 systems. Her work focuses on improving educational leadership, both formal and family and community, to create equitable educational environments with a particular focus on students, families, and communities who have been historically marginalized in education. As always, thanks for listening. We hope you're safe and healthy. And remember that for the latest analysis on education policy, you should subscribe to the NEPC newsletter at nepc.colorado.edu and follow NEPC on Twitter at NEPCTweet.